Welcome to the WRAP's Power Women Summit. I'm Corinne Foxx, and I'm so honored to be here with you. Now, 2020 has been a challenging year for everyone. I don't think we could have ever imagined what we as a society and a global community would have faced this year. I know that I couldn't. Personally, I lost a family member this year, just like hundreds of thousands of other families across the world. And at times, I felt hopeless. But I have found inspiration and light looking towards my peers, women that I can look up to, aspire to follow in their footsteps, and see as beacons of light and hope. So in this year, filled with challenges and losses, this summit is needed more than ever. We are celebrating women who not only inspire us, but are also making headway for positive change in this world. I have two little sisters, Leah and Annalise, who are 12 and 13 years old. Hello. And I make sure that I am a positive role model in their lives. But I know that it cannot just be me. I want them to grow up in a world where they can see women who look like them in positions of power, CEOs of companies, strong lead actors in film, senators and politicians on the front lines of social movements, and eventually, one day, the President of the United States. A story that I'm looking forward to sharing is my upcoming film Safety, which comes out tomorrow, December 11th on Disney+. It tells the true life story of Ray McElrathbay, a student athlete at Clemson who sacrifices everything to take care of his 11-year-old brother. The film is a great reminder of the lengths we go to for our loved ones. It's also a reminder that to get through these dark times, we have to lean on each other. We have to call a friend, a family member, check in, and be there for one another. We have to know how to ask for help. Today, The Wrap is celebrating the women who are trailblazers in their fields, paving a way for my little sisters to succeed in the world. These women are making a meaningful impact on the community, from politicians and activists to musicians and entrepreneurs. Thanks so much, The Wrap, for having me host. Let's get started. Throughout the day, we encourage you to connect and chat with each other via the Wrap Connect Slack channel to exchange personal insights and ideas. If you registered for the conference, you should have received an invitation for this in your inbox. We also encourage you to share your thoughts and findings on social media. We're using the hashtag PowerWomenSummit2020. Feel free to tag us at TheWrapWomen on Twitter, at WrapWomen on Instagram, and don't forget to sign up for the Wrap Women newsletter at WrapWomen.com for fun and fresh takes on career advice, watch lists, self-care tips, celebrity interviews, industry insights, and more. And of course, a huge thank you to the Power Women Summit event sponsors. We appreciate you making this event possible so that we can all be here today. To kick things off, we're going to take a quick trip to the Netherlands.
Hi, guys. My name is Rosa.
My name is Yarah.
And my name is Norah. We are Dead at Tappen and we're living in the Netherlands.
So the reason that we started dancing is because we love music so much and we really enjoy dancing together, having a great time together. And we also had that feeling with making this dance. And we hope that you also can see the joy and the fun that we had. And we hope to put a smile on your face and brighten your day a little bit.
Yeah, we are so happy to be part of Power Women's Summit and with our dance that we made, we can bring a little bit of light and sparkle in your day. And it's so cool that we can do this for you because we got so much support from you and it's so, so cool and nice to do this for you.
Yeah, and we also really love to make videos to perform, and we really think due COVID, this is a very good thing to also perform and still be active in dancing. So we really, really like it. Thank you so much.
We really hope that you enjoyed the video and much love from the Netherlands.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye.
Wonderful performance. Now I am honored to welcome two pioneers. Soledad O'Brien is an award-winning documentarian and journalist and founder of Soledad O'Brien Productions. She anchors and produces the Hearst TV political magazine program, Matter of Fact with Soledad O'Brien, and is a correspondent for HBO Real Sports. And now to introduce our second speaker, founder and CEO of The Wrap and The Wrap Women, Sharon Waxman.
Thanks, Corinne. I first met Cori Bush at the Sundance Film Festival in 2019. It was the premiere for Knock Down the House, a documentary about four women running for office for the first time, including Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez and Cori. And even though Cori lost the election in Missouri, she still had the fire to run again. A few months later, when we had our Power Women breakfast in Washington, D.C., I knew she had to be there. When I called her up to speak, she said, "Let me call you right back. I have to see if I can get off of work." So did I mention that Cori is also a registered nurse, a mom, and an ordained minister? Luckily, she was able to get off of work and she came to DC where she brought the audience to a standing ovation. And when it came time for the Power Women Summit last year, we knew she had to be there too. Cori joined Sophia Bush for another unforgettable conversation. It was no surprise to me that last month, Cori Bush was elected Missouri's first Black Congresswoman. We are so proud to know her and to welcome her back to the summit, this time as Congresswoman-elect Cori Bush.
Hi, my name is Cori Bush, and I'm running for U.S. Congress in Missouri's 1st District. I took every jab, every bit of adversity, every time somebody said that my hips are too big, you don't qualify for Congress, every time they said your brains are unprofessional, your skin is too dark, you don't show up on pictures, all of that kind of thing. I took all of that and I used that as fuel.
being hungry and not knowing where my next meal will come from, working for a minimum wage and working 40, 50 hours a week and then still not making enough to be able to pay my bills at the end of the week. But I started to realize this is not just happening to me. So how can I be selfish and work for myself without thinking about others? We'll meet the challenges of this moment as a movement, side by side, arm in arm, with our fists in the air, ready to serve each other until every single one of us is free. Thank you for electing me as your first Black Congresswoman.
Thank you so much, Congresswoman-elect Cori Bush. How does that sound to you, Congresswoman-elect?
It's still absolutely unbelievable. It's overwhelming and an honor at the same time.
Your resume does not match a lot of people who serve in Congress with you as well. A single parent, registered nurse, ordained pastor, activist, community organizer. Do you think more people should have your resume than I think what we often see in the halls of Congress?
I absolutely think more people should have my resume. You know, we need regular people who are doing work for people on the ground in communities, seated in Congress. And we need people just from every area, from every sect of our society, because we have to be a diverse Congress because our country is diverse. And if we don't have those perspectives, if we don't have that type of leadership where people feel touched, where people feel outreached, then we'll continue to have this disconnect that people feel between the government and the people.
Talk to me about what's been happening, because they brought you to DC already, I mean, right after the election. What are you doing?
So yes, we've been already in DC working. It's basically orientation. And I tell you, I call it Congress school. You know, I feel like I'm in school, but you know, we are basically learning the ropes. You're learning what your job is. Like if there's a description, it's a job description for a congressperson, how to, you know, hire staff, how to set up your offices, your DC offices and your DC office and your local offices, how to, you know, build these relationships with people because you have to have relationships, you know, in your caucus and outside of your caucus. And then it's the other things like, which office do you want? You know, so looking at that, and it's just, it's so many pieces. Like I'm already outdone by how much information they've given us that we're supposed to like learn. But the great thing about it is we have help. You know, I'm so glad for staff. I'm so glad for people who have experience in this working alongside me.
I read, and I was thinking of you the other day because there was a story that said that you were wearing a mask that said Brianna Taylor on it, and that people thought that that was your name, right? So that it didn't really ring a bell with them, and so everybody was calling you Brianna, and obviously I couldn't decide what was more annoying, right? That they didn't know your name. I mean, you're the first African-American woman elected from your state in Congress, so that alone you'd stick out, but also that the name Brianna Taylor like didn't kind of ring a bell. And I guess I just felt frustrated, and I'm curious how that made you feel, because I wanted to slam my head against a wall, and it didn't happen to me, it happened to you. What was that like?
Yeah, so to set up how it happened, it was the very first day. It was of orientation. Orientation had not started yet. We had all just entered the auditorium. And so people were walking around, just greeting one another before the first speaker. And so people were walking up to me. I just put my stuff down. I hadn't even walked out away from my seat yet to go meet with other people when people were walking up to me. And they were walking up and it was just, oh, hi, Brianna, how are you? Good to meet you. I'm such and such. And the first time it happened, I just paused and my mind was racing. It was like, okay, is this malicious? Is this serious? Is this like, what is it? Did I just hear Brianna? Like, what am I? And so then I had to discern the spirit because I'm like, okay,
I need to figure out what this really is. And it was actually just the person did not have a clue. And so when I told them who she was, then it was this look like, oh, okay, nice to meet you. And then the next person, and it was about six different people who came up to me. And I told all of them exactly who she was. And then the last person, I said, you know what? I hope that you are not one of those people who had a lot to say about the protest in a negative way, who talked against the protest, who talked against Antifa, who talked against Black Lives Matter, who talked against activists, who spoke against, you know, us doing this work all of this time. And I hope you weren't one of those ones that did that and you didn't even know who we were fighting for.
Yeah, I think that's frustrating. Yeah, I think that's really frustrating. Does it give you pause about entering Congress? Or maybe conversely, it makes you feel like, well, it's about time. I've got a lot of work to do.
It didn't give me pause. It helped me to see even the more. That's why this voice and the voice of so many others like me have to be represented. Each one of us brings something different. And for me, you know, there are many people who would like to silence me. There are many people who feel like, you know, we're tired of hearing about Black Lives Mattering. We're tired of hearing, you know, Cori, the activist, and, you know, she's always talking about this, you know, this particular subject. But you know what? Because we're still dying, I'm going to keep talking about it. Because to me, death is final. It's final. There's no coming back from that. So Mike is not coming back. Tamir is not coming back. You know, Rakia is not coming back. Sandra can't come back. You know, and so it's not good enough to me. John Crawford cannot come back. And so if no matter what people want, as far as silencing me or feeling like I'm going too far, too far was the death at the hands of a police officer that was supposed to be doing their job, protecting and serving. And since that the folks in Congress have not made sure that was taken care of by now, and in all forms of government, in policing, if that was not taken care of. So folks like me, the whole movement for Black Lives, the movement itself, Black Lives Matter, every other group, every other individual person, we are coming in and we're coming in force. And I hope that there are other people in this country that will be running, thinking about Black Lives, running in 2022, because I'm here to help.
I mentor kids, and I'm curious. I think a lot of times they don't have a great sense of what they can be because they don't have a big scope ahead of them of what has existed before. Did you want to be in Congress before when you were growing up? All right, I capitulate. That was a stupid question. I mean, what kid was like, you know what I want to be when I grow up in Congress? What do you think led you to coming into Congress? I obviously you'd run for election before. This was not your first time, but as a child growing up and with some, you know, struggles, what was it in you that made you feel like this made sense as a step?
So I never had a desire to run for any office. As a matter of fact, because my dad has been in office for so long, most of my life, and I saw this good person with this amazing heart give so much to the community, and then all of this, the greed and corruption and just all these darts coming back at him. And so I said I would never do it. I told my dad, I said, I'll never run for office. I'll never do politics. And you know, I went into ministry. I became a nurse. And but when Michael Brown was murdered, you know, I just felt like, okay, I'm clergy. I'm a nurse. I can be a medic on the street. And I started going to the protests to do that, to just serve on the ground. But what I saw over and over again was we were out there getting our butts kicked by the police. If this was our own community where we worked, where we ate, where we, you know, spent time, where we worshiped, where all of these things, this was our community. And it looked like something out of civil rights footage from the 1960s that I just couldn't understand it. And so when I realized, though, that there are people who are supposed to be representing us in this moment that are paid to represent us, are so many elected officials, and I felt like they should have been standing up for us, and instead they weren't. They were some of them, not all. Some of them were using it for photo ops. And I had to, and so someone asked me, you know, to run for office. It's an activist who has since been murdered. He asked me to run for the very first seat. I said no. But then the next day when some community leaders asked me again, I just felt this yes in my spirit that I just needed to make this step. And I thought about my son. I thought about my daughter. What could I say if my son or my daughter or another loved one ends up the next hashtag and I could have done something about it? I couldn't bear that.
You've run before in the Democratic primary against Congressman William Lacey Clay, who's held that seat for like 19 years or some really long tenure. What do you think was the difference this time as opposed to the last time that you ran against him and lost? What made the difference?
A few things, I think. So first, running against him the first time, so I already had some name recognition from my very first, from being an activist in my community, and then my very first run. But then when I ran against Congressman Clay in 2018, you know, just continuing to run, we started to gain some name recognition. And then when my sister, Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, came to town to stump for me, that added more name recognition. We were in a film together that is called Knock Down the House, a beautiful film. That helped with name recognition. Oh my gosh, I love it. That helped with name recognition. And then I became a 2020 surrogate, national surrogate for Bernie Sanders' presidential campaign. That added to it. But with that, also added fundraising. So fundraising really was a big piece because then I was able to get the name out even more. And then COVID-19 happened. When COVID-19 hit our community, I ended up very, very sick. And I was sick for about 2 months. And because it was at the end of my race, I had to go public about it because people were so used to me being visible and in the community that I couldn't breathe. And so I had to be public. So I went and I just did a live video and I allowed people to see, you know, me in the hospital, me even at home, just not really, really struggling to breathe. And that, it definitely helped people to see like, okay, Cori's been talking about Medicare for all for a very long time. Cori's been talking about needing access to healthcare, but in actual care. Cori's been saying that job status should not be connected to healthcare for all of this time. Now we understand why she's been saying this. And then what people also saw was I was sick for 2 months off of my campaign, but then, well, mostly off of my campaign. And then as soon as I felt better, I was better for 3 days after 2 months, 3 days. And I was at the very first protest for George Floyd and Breonna Taylor. Couldn't even march because I was still pretty weak. But then I started to lead and help organize those protests. So people saw, wow, Cori was doing that before. She still does it now, even while she's running, even though people are saying, you're a congressional candidate. You can't do that. You know, Cori's the same person. So people decided, look, we want to fight her as somebody that's going to be who they say.
Tell me about your constituents, because you and Congressman Clay are very, very different. And how, you know, we're at a time when America's so divided. If you were Donald Trump, right, you'd be like, forget them. I'm gonna represent the people who voted for me and everybody else I don't care about. And I get the feeling that's not gonna be your strategy. But walk me through your constituents, and then how do you sort of bring them over to you?
Yeah, our district is, you know, we are a very blue district. And I think the thing is here is because we've been represented by the same family since 1969. So 52 years, the exact same family. Dad had it for 32 years. Son had it for almost 20. So because of that, people were just used to a particular thing. Now what we're seeing is people are like, okay, there can be more. So our district is, you know, we are a majority African-American district, but our district is very, you know, we are oftentimes fluctuating between number one and number two for homicides and violent crime. We are number one 6 years 6 years running for police killings per capita in this country, even though Ferguson happened in this district. We are a community, we're fighting environmental racism, poverty, and so many other things that are happening all across the country. And so, yes, the congressman and myself, we are very, very different in a lot of ways. And I think right now, that's what people were saying, was like, okay, we need something different. And we are looking also for representation. There are so many women and young girls who have said to me, little girls and even little boys, that run up to me and grab me when they see me. You know, they're like, oh, that's Cori Bush. You know, people feel represented. You know, whether it's me, the fact that I'm a woman, or the fact that I'm of this age that I am, the fact that I'm a regular person, I'm a nurse, I started out in early childhood, so in so many ways, and then I'm somebody who's been evicted. I've lived in my car with my two babies, you know, moving it around St. Louis. You know, I've been a low-wage worker. I'm currently uninsured, you know, so people see themselves and their own struggles in me, and they feel like, look, if you came from where I came from, so I feel like you are the one that can help us out of these struggles.
Your agenda is a progressive agenda: criminal justice, police reform, abortion rights, Medicare for all, $15 minimum wage, tuition-free state college and trade school, canceling student debt. Is this going to be a challenge today? You've heard all the discussions about the brouhaha over, you know, defund the police, should have been framed that way. Should anybody have said that? I mean, we saw the back and forth before. I think even President Trump capitulated that he had lost the election to Joe Biden. Is this going to be a challenge as we head into a divided electorate?
I don't believe it'll be a challenge. I think that it's just going to take us listening to one another, because the thing is, this is the reason why I'm going to Congress. I don't care about a name, title, fame. If this is not about my career, this is about saving lives 100%. I am only trying to save lives and then help build a better quality of life for my people. That is what I'm doing. I'm tired of St. Louis struggling. I'm tired of us hurting. St. Louis has to be the center of everything I do. And the root of what I do is just a love for humanity. And so I'm going in it with those eyes, looking out of it from that lens. And so no matter what people, I know people feel like, oh, defund the police is the reason why I lost. Oh, you know, it's all of those things, you know, but the reality is, had we tackled police brutality in a real way years ago, because Congress has been around for a very long time, had we tackled it appropriately back then, had we done the real work, then we wouldn't be here right now and Mike would be alive, you know, and so many others would be alive. And so because of that, it didn't happen. So now I'm here. And so I have help, though. I'm not going in alone doing this work. Jamal Bowman is right there, you know, right with me. Mondaire Jones is right with me. You know, Nakima Williams is right there with me. So we might not all be 100% on every single issue, but on this issue and the ones that you named, we are right in line together. So I think that it's about us making sure that our message is clear. And it's not even about being, you know, like just walking in trying to challenge people and walking in trying to be divisive. You know, I need to expose you to something that you may not know. And because one thing that I do know is there is not one person out of 435 Congress members plus the 100 in the Senate, there is not one other than me who knows exactly what happened on the streets of Ferguson all for over 400 days. Not one of them knows the real story of what happened the way that I do, you know? And so that is a perspective that I have to take, because if I'm silent, we won't get the change we need.
Yeah, I was sort of surprised. There was a Fox News poll a couple weeks ago, and on all of those issues, the Fox News viewer surprised me by supporting them, like in the 75-80 percentile. You should take up that poll, because it was a bit of a shocker on abortion rights, on free college, on student. I was like, wow, that was not what I would have guessed. Do you think women approach leadership differently than men?
I think so. And I can speak about a lot of the women I've met in politics. I can't speak for all, but I would say I've seen something different in the women that I have met along the way. So many have talked about, this like feeling of taking care of people, and not necessarily being a career move, that it's a move of just needing to better their communities and starting from their own, in their own family. And so I think that is something that I'm seeing different, because there have been quite a few men that I've talked to that have been a little different. It's, yeah, I want to affect my community, but I'm building this career. And so I think that maybe that is a little different in some ways. Like I said, it's not 100%, because there are some like Jamal Bowman, he and I talk, quite a bit, and he's definitely of the same mindset that I am. But I think that there are also some women, many women, who are not from generational wealth, that are running for these seats. And I think that that's what makes a difference as well. Many of us are from the working class or working poor and running for office. So I think that we have a different perspective. So, and that's what we're taking with us.
Yeah, that's a great point. Final question for you is about strategy. One thing I think that AOC has done that's brilliant, and I've spent a lot of time covering politics, but she does a lot of like, let me explain to you how this works. I'm going to show you how this meeting happened. Here are the people who are in this meeting. Here's who came to lecture us. And I felt like it was a 101 on Congress. And as a person who's done a number of interviews with elected officials over the years, I've never been assigned to cover Congress or the White House, it was just really helpful. And I wonder if you have a strategy as well to, as busy as you're going to be, also educate your constituents around like what Congress is supposed to be doing for them.
Yes. that's something that I actually ran on. And I've been running on that since 2016 when I first ran for the U.S. Senate, because I said that I want to be what I wanted to see. And that's something that I wanted to know those things. It's because it seems like this big secret. What happens in DC is this secret, and all you get to know is what is rolled out in the media. And I just didn't always believe it. I was that kid that had to touch the stove to know it was hot. Like that literally, that actually happened to me with me and my dad. So I will be the one, just like when I brought up recently about, shopping at thrift stores. Like I want to be very as open and as transparent and vulnerable. Just like when I was running for office, that's who people know me as, and I will continue to do that. So yeah, going into like the day that I get my office, I will be talking about the procedure with that, and then let everybody, the moment that I get to see my office, the world will get to see my office, at the same time. Like I'm bringing and I've always said it, I'm bringing St. Louis to DC. Like St. Louis is like in my bag, I want people to see. And not only that, you're going to see the good and the bad. You get to hear, like I've been talking about, like not even getting a paycheck. Like I haven't had an actual paycheck in months, and I won't see an actual paycheck from Congress until February 1st of 2021.
I always love all those details, right? Because I mean, think about it, right? Who can actually just go for months and months without a paycheck? There's only a certain kind of people who can say, oh, no worries, you don't have to send me a check, I'm good for 6 months. Like that's, yeah, I love those details, and I love that transparency. And I think when you bring younger people into Congress, that transparency is almost like second nature, because you guys are just younger and you share a lot more, certainly on social media, et cetera, et cetera. I love it. I think it's great. Congresswoman-elect Cori Bush, congratulations to you. What a great opportunity for me to have a chance to talk to you. And we're excited to see what you're going to do in Congress.
Thank you. Thank you for doing this.
My honor.
Thank you, Soledad and Congresswoman-elect Bush. Up next, in celebration of electing the first Black South Asian female vice president, Wrap Woman has asked the women of Hollywood what Kamala Harris means to them. Let's take a look.
Hi, Kamala.
Dear Kamala.
Dear Kamala.
Dear Kamala.
Dear Kamala.
Kamala Harris is dope.
To me, what Kamala Harris's election to the vice presidency means is that my two little sisters, who are 12 and 13, get to grow up in a world where a woman that looks like them is holding one of the top two executive offices in the country. And knowing that they too could one day become the vice president or even the president of the United States.
The election of Kamala Harris to the vice presidency means so much more than just another political win. What it really means is that my daughter, growing up in America, previously aspired to destinations that were unknown. And now, not only does she have a roadmap, but she knows exactly what it would look like for her to get there.
Your election to the vice presidency means that history will repeat itself and hopefully do us one better by making you president someday.
The daughters of immigrants, like my two girls, no longer have any limits on how big they can dream. It means that kind and compassionate is on the same footing as strong and powerful. And I would be amiss if I didn't say thank you from the bottom of my heart for making sneakers a normal part of the business attire.
She gives me hope for a future where we've never been before. Her integrity, her values, her hard work, her perseverance, these are things that I can relate to. I have faith with Kamala as our vice president that anything is possible.
You inspire my generation as well as ones to come, challenging us to believe our potential can be far more than what our current situation tells us we can achieve. As the first African-American and South Asian American woman in the vice presidency and the daughter of a single mother, my heart bursts with pride at what you personally represent for me.
I and so many girls just like me got to witness something we've always known, even when it's hard to see, and that is that we are capable of achieving anything. Your hard work, confidence, perseverance, and yes, swag that landed you in the office is what we know will continue to empower and sustain you as you continue to lead. You have become proof of our magic.
Genuine hope for the future of America and inspiration to young girls to show that they can be and do anything that they put their minds to.
It means that women, and especially women of color, will have a voice, will be seen and heard at the highest levels of our government. And I'm so supportive, I'm so, so excited, and I can't wait to help get the work done.
Hope, it means aspiration. It means inspiration. It means if you can see it, you can be it. And that's very important for people who look like me. Kamala, thank you very much for being a strong leader in terms of progressive and positive change for the future, for our children.
It means that badassery is okay. It means that I too can live in a world where being interrupted is no longer acceptable, where my voice matters, where my son's voice matters, and where he knows that the future is bright and whatever it is that he wants to accomplish for his daughters or his granddaughters is certainly possible.
Kamala Harris's election to the vice presidency means that little girls all across the country, little girls all across the world, will know that being a girl doesn't have to stop you from achieving anything.
It also means that my nieces will now grow up in a time and a place where it's not only normal, but celebrated to see women in leadership and in the highest office of our nation.
As a woman in a traditionally male profession, I often think of you. When I'm staring at a room full of men, I think of your voice and your expertise, your high top chucks, your I'm speaking. We have your back. We believe in you.
A brand new narrative for women in leadership. It was only a century ago that women in this country did not even have the right to vote. And today, the light bulb of possibility just went on for millions of girls and women all over the world.
It means we are seen. As a Black woman in America, to know that someone with an experience so similar to mine is now at a table that impacts the entire world to help make decisions for cultural and generational change. I feel inspired, I feel motivated, and I hope everyone just feels encouraged. Congrats.
Dear Kamala, I think it's very inspiring that there are people in high positions of power that look like me so that I have people to look up to.
Thank you, Kamala, for being such an inspiration. We can't wait to see what you do as our vice president.
We all have our own journey ahead of us, our own hopes and dreams. We'll pass many milestones, moments that define you and drive you to achieve even more. So celebrate everyone, because success isn't just about where you want to get to. It's also about how you get there.
And cut on rehearsal.
Now I'm excited to welcome back up to the stage Sharon Waxman to introduce the WRAP's inaugural Changemakers list.
Thanks, Corinne. This year, the WRAP is excited to announce our first ever Changemakers list presented by Cadillac. The list singles out those women who helped save entertainment in this extraordinary year of pandemic and economic disruption. These women pivoted, they dug in, they found ways to bring innovation and creativity to the challenges of this year. Today, I'm excited to be speaking to two of the women from this list, HBO's head of drama, Francesca Orsi, as well as HBO's head of comedy, Amy Gravitt. Francesca was responsible for HBO's massive showing at the Emmys this year with wins for Watchmen and Succession, and Amy's comedy team has developed hits such as I May Destroy You, Insecure, and a Black Lady sketch show. Welcome to Francesca and Amy.
Thank you.
Hi. I'm excited to meet you guys. Haven't even met you before now. But of course, I'm a massive consumer of your work. So I'm I'm an intimate without actually ever having met you. But what was so interesting to me about taking the measure of the work each of you are doing in your respective divisions and how it was relevant to what we're doing here at the summit has to do with the fact that you're really pushing forward on a lot of cultural beats. We've had the Black Lives Matter movement that's a kind of a social uprising this year, but you've had shows in your pipeline, in your development that are very forward-looking, whether it's Watchmen or whether it's Insecure, for a long time. And so I want to talk to each of you about the kind of intentionality of that, or if it actually was talent that was coming to you that you decided to give a shot that at another time would not have come to you. Let me start with you, Amy.
I think we're very intentional about how we approach both our developments and our current slate. And for me on the comedy side, it's essential for the audience to recognize themselves in the characters we portray and hopefully laugh at themselves watching our characters. So I think in order to accomplish that, you have to show a variety of tones and perspectives and voices. And I think when we're looking for talent, we're trying to explore the notion that we know that the human experience isn't a monolithic one. And I think it's important to curate talents that speak to that, especially women and people of color whose stories haven't necessarily been granted that nuance in the past. So in the case of Insecure, Issa very intentionally was wanting to put a character on screen that she didn't see when she was growing up. And as a result, she made the concept of being awkward iconic in a comedic way. Like Larry David.
I was about to say, she talks about being the Black female version of Larry David, and of course she came from the internet, from like YouTube, and was given a platform that really I don't know that we would have seen a decade ago, for example. I think that's amazing. Francesca, can you address that same question, but obviously
sure.
You're in the drama category.
Sure. Examples like Watchmen or Lovecraft, those of course came through the door well before Black Lives Matter, but at the center of both those shows, our showrunners, Damon Lindelof and Misha Green, were probing something that very much existed in our zeitgeist and reflected the spirit of our times. The fact that it erupted eventually in 2020 with Black Lives Matter, it is besides the point in that it existed within our culture. It has been an ongoing crisis within our nation for so many years, and that these two creators came in wanting to probe discrimination in America, racism, and have a frank conversation about these really tough, hard, uncomfortable issues. That's what our buy-in was all about. It was knowing in those two writers coming into the room, knowing that they were fearless and courageous in wanting to tackle those themes, that we knew we had something special and something unique and something that would have an audience think in the way they have.
How was that in the room? For example, like, they're pitching this, they're separate shows, so I don't want to conflate them. But Watchmen's, I mean, yes, it's based on a comic book with a past, with a history. But first of all, HBO is really not in the business of making comic books, generally, hasn't been. Succession, totally HBO's wheelhouse. Watchmen, really not so much. So, like, how far, and also it's kind of hard to imagine because you're really mixing superhero, I'm not going to say sci-fi, but like a little bit, you know, fantasy with really serious topics of social justice and racism. Did that, and so I imagine that it's hard for you to imagine that when someone's coming in to pitch that to you, even if it's Damon Lindelof.
Yeah, I mean, they're daring conversations and issues, but we tend to lean in when something feels, again, a little bit more challenging or uncomfortable. While in many ways we want our shows to go down easy, we will always want to leave our audiences thinking for at least a week so that they tune in that following Sunday. If we don't have the opportunity immediately to binge it. But in the event of Watchmen, I'll just say that Damon came across the massacres of that occurred around 1921.
The Tulsa massacres.
Mm-hmm. And he had never read about it, heard about it, and was shocked and almost ashamed that he didn't know about it and had never learned about it.
By the way, I felt the same when I saw that episode. I learned about Tulsa, I am not proud to admit, through seeing Watchmen and reading about Watchmen. Mm-hmm.
That's right. And so many people have said the same. And that catalyzed something within himself. And it's the reason why it was dovetailed in the already existing universe of Watchmen. And he was very deliberate in casting the entire writer's room as mostly African-American writers and ensuring that truly their voice and their opinions and why something that atrocious could ever happen in our country. And it sadly that it wasn't that far or long ago. But again, he's wanting to provoke, and he felt like this is something that the world should know about. So he used Watchmen as a platform to do that.
Have the two of you, because I know your work is really different, and I'm going to just say I May Destroy You is not a rip-roaring comedy, okay? So
no.
That, I'm not even sure.
Although, not to interrupt, but I literally on my wall over there have a quote from Michaela written about comedy. That's one of my favorite quotes.
Which is?
Basically, it says, "I didn't add humor. Humor is always there at every party, funeral, and war. Although often uninvited, she's always there. And I, for some reason, always seem to find myself in a corner with her."
God,
which I love.
That's so good.
I know.
That's so good. The spirit of Michaela Cole is with us today.
Yes.
That's amazing. That's amazing. That's another piece of program that is just wildly daring and really ahead of the curve. And I'm going to ask you guys afterwards whether you compare notes with your work or you just both happen to be doing things that were so that turned out to be so on point for the culture and where we are. But let's just remind our viewers that Michaela Cole's piece is about sexual assault. It is about the experience of a woman in, I'll say in entertainment in a way, because she's a writer. So she's in that community, although what happens to her is not, you know, one of the kind of things that we've been, that have been exposed in entertainment, but still it's the issue and how it impacts her. Go ahead.
What I was going to say, it's interesting hearing Francesca talk about her shows, because I feel like the I May Destroy You conversation is almost the inverse of that, which is Michaela took something that was a very personal experience, took the time to then to process it. And the writing, as you say, of the script was a way to bring closure that she didn't necessarily have in her own life with her own experience. But she took something very personal and then broadened it out and built out the world in a very real present-day London and expanded it to a conversation about how we all treat one another. So there are access points with different characters that aren't necessarily, I mean, their stories are interwoven with Michaela's, but might not necessarily be a part of the narrative through line of the script. And so I think for her and for comedies, it's about taking, you know, some personal feeling you have or personal experience and broadening it out to create the story.
It's and it was incredible the impact that it had. Not, you know, just sort of came out of left field. Before, and it still continues to resonate, I must say, and I'm sure we'll be hearing from her more. Before we run out of time, I want to ask you guys, how do you frame your feeling of the roles that you have, which are really potentially very powerful roles because these shows have such an impact on our culture? How do you sort of frame it as women in this position that in the past 100 years or however long HBO's been around, if you want to include that, but I would say in general was a role that was really a man's role. And granted, there have been women that have been have risen in roles like yours, but you do you feel a special responsibility to be inclusive in what you're doing, or as Francesca said earlier, just to be daring in general?
I mean, I would say that it's incredibly important to me and to all of us at HBO. It's not just something that we are looking for or loosely wanting, but something that we as a company endorse, and it almost feels like a mandate. But as a female leader of a division, absolutely inclusion is critical. And Everybody across each and every one of our shows. I can't say it existed in times past. I've been at the company for a very long time, but now and moving forward, everybody has a seat at the table. At least it's at least our intention each and every time. And I'm talking about cast, crew, writers, directors, everybody involved, bottom up.
I was going to say that too about everybody touching the show. We work with craftsmen at every level of the process. And so if the folks on the crew or in the development process or within other halls of HBO have a personal connection to a project, the audience is going to feel that in the final series and feel that connection, no matter whether you're talking about, you know, somebody placing a prop in a specific place or, you know, somebody pulling a specific piece of wardrobe together. It's all part of the vision that creates the larger slate for HBO.
Yeah. Well, you've had an extraordinarily successful run, the both of you. I just want to say congratulations again for being on the Changemakers list. So well deserved.
Thank you.
All power to you guys in continuing to do great work. And thank you so much for joining us here at the Summit. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you Sharon. So much. Thanks.
It's been an honor.
Every year at the Power Women Summit, WRAP Women spotlights the International Media Fund's Courage Winners. These women have risked their lives to tell the truth and find the stories of their communities. Here to introduce this year's winners is the IWMF's Executive Director, Elisa Lees Munoz. But before we bring her out, here's a clip to show you what the IWMF is all about.
Telling the truth is dangerous work, and women journalists face unique threats. If we censor, silence, and attack women's voices, we'll never get the full story. The IWMF has been working to support women journalists for the last 30 years. We at the IWMF really believe in the need for a diversity of the news media, the principle that the news media should reflect the society on which it's reporting. Through a global pandemic, a racial reckoning in the US, and the election of a lifetime, women journalists have been on the front lines, demonstrating day in and day out the true nature of essential work. In order to secure their work, in order to save journalism, we must save these journalists. In 2020 alone, when their work lapsed due to COVID-19, the IWMF has supported nearly 400 journalists from more than 65 countries with emergency grants. We supplied protective gear for those reporting on the front lines, offered hostile environment training for 700 journalists covering protests, and funded mental health support for Black journalists enduring trauma while reporting on their communities. While much has changed over three decades, women are still underrepresented in the news, and we know our work is far from over. Our programs and resources have propelled thousands of women journalists' careers, supported the production of countless bylines, and helped them to stay safer on the job. We have so much more to do. Please join us.
Hello, I'm Elisa Lees Munoz, the Executive Director of the International Women's Media Foundation, and I'm pleased to bring you some of the bravest women you will ever meet, those who risk everything to bring you the truth. 2020 has been a challenging year for all of us, and for journalists on whose work we depend, the sheer number of major stories they have had to cover is daunting, from SARS in Nigeria, social unrest in the United States, and of course, the global pandemic, to name just a few. Yet the demise of the news media has left many journalists around the world with little or no safety net. And women journalists and journalists of color are often the first and the hardest hit in moments of crisis. While the existential threat to journalism itself continues, it's our firm belief that you cannot save journalism if you do not save journalists. This is why the IWMF provides support and opportunity to journalists around the world who risk it all to bring us the truth. In our time together, you'll meet some of the women who embody this principle every day, the IWMF's 2020 Courage in Journalism Award winners. They'll be introduced to you by our friend, a Courage in Journalism Award winner in her own right, and senior international correspondent for CNN based in London, Nima. Thank you, Nima.
Thank you so much. It is such a privilege to be here to introduce the 2020 Courage in Journalism winners. Jessica Arrow reported from the front lines of Russian information warfare. Sulafa Majdi, who sadly was arrested in Cairo in November of 2019 and is still imprisoned. And the two who are joining us today, Yakeen Bido, who broadcasts from one of the most dangerous environments on earth in Idlib, and Gulchehra Hoja, who reports on Uyghur detention camps in spite of the fact that her entire family faces constant government surveillance and harassment. Thank you both so much for joining us. Yakeen, marhaba bik. And Gulchehra, thank you so much for being able to be with us today. My first question to you both is, there is a very specific place often that female journalists occupy, which is at the cross section of both harassment that you receive from malevolent actors, but also the misogyny that faces women in general, let's be honest, not just female journalists. So I want to ask you both. First to you, Gulchehra, how do you navigate that? And what is your experience with that?
So how should I begin? It's not just from the time Chinese government starting put Uyghur people in the concentration camp. Actually, my story, actually my challenge, beginning soon after I worked in Radio Free Asia. Chinese government instantly threatened my family. After 2001, I joined RFA because the RFA is the only news outlet outside China that has the Uyghur language. More so for the Uyghur service staff who themselves grew up in Xinjiang and for whom the work exact a heavy emotional toll. Many have had family members in China detained as a direct result of their reporting. And every day it seems another permanent Uyghur goes missing. Another symbol of Uyghurs, Uyghur life is erased. And the situation grows blacker. Do you think that I do not want to welcome you every day with good news? And yet, as a journalist, what I report on is mostly beyond my control. It has been 3 years in a row that we as Uyghur journalists have received no other news than the horrific description of the life of Uyghurs full of pain, suffering, and deaths from the invisible war zone from my homeland, where the 21st surveillance state is secretly managing the concentration camps, prisons, and slave labor on an industrial scale. Now, China is aggressively cutting this communication link between us and them as the last link that they have had with the outside world in the air. Still worse, it is eradicating not only their voice, but also more alarmingly, their lives. What if you are a female journalist exposing the crimes of an authoritarian state as China? You will definitely pay an incredibly high price for your work. And anonymous threats and your family members in the hands of the state are taken hostage. Forced to you to give in. My family back home in Urumqi been harassed and threatened by Chinese government since I start working in RFA. Chinese government erased all my old recorders. The worst moment in my career is that time I heard over 20 relatives disappeared into what Chinese government refers to as re-education camps. February 2018. After I reporting on China mass detention of Uyghurs in Xinjiang, I lost contact with my family in the region. Daily lives are riddled with distress, fear, and worry for my families. And friends is hard to bear. My family suffering just for what I am doing, but I need to continue.
I was gonna say.
I am because RFA is the only voice for Uyghur people, as you know.
That's what I was gonna say. And yet you don't give in, you persist.
You have to. Because voice matter, because people's only hope outside Uyghurs have freedom to speak up. So they feel they will speak up for us. So we are the voice. We are free. We can speak the truth. Nobody can stop us. So I need to continue. For myself, for my family, for my people.
Thank you. Yakeen, I'd like to ask you the same question. خلاص انا عاوز اسالك نفس السؤال اللي على قول هو انه احكي لنا عن تجربتك كصحفيه ما هي الضغوط اللي انت بتواجهيها كامراه بتمارسي هذه المتاعب
طبعا اول شيء بدي اعتذر لانه الانترنت عندي ضعيف ثاني شيء الصحافه دائما كان متعارف عنها انه هي حكرا على الرجال فوقت اللي بدها تفكر اي فتاة تنضم لهي المهنة او المهمة انا بعتبرها فرح يكون عليها كتير صعوبة بداية لتقنع ذاتها انه هي قادرة تستمر بهذا الطريق وانا هذا الشيء واجهته بالبداية لكن بوجود عائلتي ومحيط القريب مني كان في تشجيع انه ما له غلط يعني فمن بداية المشوار حاولت ابدأ بالصحافة المكتوبة هذا الموضوع سهل علي الأمر بديت بالتدريج صحافة مكتوبة صحافة مسموعة انتقلت للصحافة المرئية يلي وجدت فيها ذاتي أكثر شيء يعني حسيت أنه أنا حققت إنجاز لحالي بداية أنه قدرت أوصل شيء ممكن ما الكل قادر يوصل له أو بسبب الضغوطات المجتمعية العادات التقاليد البيئة المحيطة خاصة أنه نحن ببلد عم نشهد حرب نزاع قتال قصف مستمر وجود عدة أطراف للصراع وجود عدة فئات مسيطرة هاي الأمور كلها كانت بتخليني أحياناً أنه أقول ليش أنا عم أشتغل يعني أنا وصلت لمرحلة أنا ما عم أستفيد يعني ما عم بقدر فيد الناس المحيطة فيه فليش أنا موجودة لسا لكن الحمد لله أنه في بعض البوادر واللي منها هي حصولي على الجائزة اللي أبداً ما كنت متوقعتها وكان خير لأنه يخليني أرجع أستمر أو استمر بنشاط أكبر.
شنو اللي بخليك تكون عندك العزيمة إنك تستمري في 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 وسط الضغوط الاجتماعية والمحلية والظروف ال يعني صعبة لدرجة ذاتها لا توصف؟
وجودي بين سكان أو بين فئات كتير هي مستضعفة نساء. أطفال عم يتعرضوا للاضطهاد عم يتعرضوا لقتل جماعي لإبادة جماعية فترة من الفترات صرنا ما إنه نحن عايشين لليوم الثاني القصف كان شديد برة جوة طائرات نظام الأسد طائرات روسيا يعني كل الناس كانت بحاجة لأنه حدا يقول هيك عم بصير فينا فأنا شفت حالي إنه قادرة ربما وصل صوت الناس المستضعفين الموجودين هون بين صورة المجازر الحقيقة إنه الرسالة اللي لازم توصل حتى أنا لو ما قدرت أنا أكيد كان في زملاء وزميلات عم بيحاولوا ينقلوا نفس الصورة بس كل واحد فينا كان له مهمة خاصة يعني بجوز أنا أقدر أنقل من جانب معين ما وصل فيه أكثر يعني كنت عم حاول أشتغل لأنه أنا واحدة من هذول الناس ربما أنا أتعرض لنفس الموقف أو تعرضت لنفس الشيء اللي عم بيعيشوه فلازم نفرج العالم برا المأساة الإنسانية اللي عم بتصير فينا
Yarin makes a really amazing point about the fact that it's not just this sense that she is speaking on behalf of disenfranchised people whose voices otherwise would not be heard, but also that she is speaking on behalf of herself. And that question, that point, leads me to ask, Gul, did you feel that you also had to speak? Because today it's someone else, perhaps tomorrow it's you. Did you feel that same sense that you had to not just be a voice for the disenfranchised, but also a voice for your own community?
Yes, of course. Even it has been very difficult covering the situation facing the Uyghurs because it's a vast and a complex story that always changing first. This is one of the biggest crises, but it's happening in one of the most restricted media environments where it's very hard to get the news out of. This is especially true now, but has been before 2017, before the situation intensified, before there was a surveillance state, before Uyghurs were being put in the detention camps by the hundreds and thousands and millions. Although Although we have an advantage because of your rewards, we know the language, we know the culture, we can understand and see what's happening from our sources and the clues that we receive, we can put together a picture. For example, I have been able to first report about family separation after the both parents being arrested and the children's left behind. So they're also the create of orphanages for Uyghur children whose parents have been detained, because we RFA, the first news outlet focus on this camp issue. So we find out so many families, just like my family, whole family was taken to the concentration camp. That raised question for us. How about children? Where they put those children? Because my own nephews missing. I don't know where they are. It's 2 years, 4 years, 10 years old kids. So it's raised question for us. So I did that situation and then we find out. Another story. You maybe heard about us, RFA News or other news outlets. US Border Control seized 13 tons of hair, the wigs, suspected to be from the internment camps in Xinjiang. And this is the based on my and other key investigation report. Because we were women's hair shorn from them involuntarily in the concentration camps. Then we also find out there were massive hair production companies moved in the hotel area, the Uyghur region, at the same time Chinese government building the camps. And those hair products made by forced labor and being sold into the US and elsewhere. When I speak to several camp survivors, they all describe having their heads shaved off immediately. Into the detention camps. Then, because we know the Uyghur culture, they don't cut off their hair. It's traditionally culture. So I also, feel something in there. So because we're talking about millions of Uyghur women's hair. So how much hair could be and what they do with those millions of people's hair? Then we find out other news. And my recent investigation report showed internment camps in Aksu, separated by a large crematorium. You know, we are Muslim people. We don't need cremation centers. Not only that, we also discovered one of the diseases control hospital in Aksu has been turned one of this camp. Large cremation center, 500 meters away. 2 minutes drive to an airport with organ fast lane. This fast lane also opened same time was the internment camp create in 2017. So all those of what some experts believe could be a system for the harvesting organs from the detainees. Since 2017, 3 million of Uyghurs are now put in the concentration camps. So how can we stop? So we have to bring this news to the world because that area is so close.
Thank you so much, Gulchehra. You You are doing extraordinary work, both of you, you and Yakeen. Yakeen, I wish we had so much more time, but unfortunately, we're running out of time. So I just wanted to ask my last question to Yakeen. ما هو يعني النصيحة اللي بتعطيها للصحفيات النابغات العاقين يشتغلوا العاوزين يشتغلوا مثلك في نفس المجال؟ ما هي النصيحة اللي بتعطيها بالذات انه نحن مع يعني عارفين انه ثقافتنا ودائما مجتمعاتنا شوية مغلقة؟
لا بداية قبل ما أعطي نصيحة لأي زميلة عملت بهذا المجال أو حابة هي تشتغل بهذا المجال رح أقول لها إنه الإعلام هو بيقدر يغير كتير مسارات خاصة إحنا المأساة اللي عنا يمكن الإعلام لعب دور كبير فيها ممكن أنا وصلت لدرجة إنه أنا حسيت حالي عاجزة ليش أنا عم صور ليش أنا عم أكتب العالم كله شايفنا وما حدا قادر يوقف شلال الدم اللي موجود عنا فحس حالي إنه ما لازم أقدم خلص ما لازم أستمر يعني أنا ممكن أكون بعد أي أميتة فشغلي بجوز ما يجيب نتيجة ومثلي أمثال اللي عم يشتغلوا بمجال الصحافة إني حسوا نفس الإحساس إنه الإعلام بسوريا هو ما قدر يجيب نتيجة لدى الدول لدى العالم اللي عم بيشوف هاي المأساة القتل الدمار هذا كله يمكن بيخلي أي حدا ما يتجرأ ليفوت في هذا المجال خاصة الاستهداف المباشر للإعلاميين من عدة أطراف وعلى رأسهم نظام الأسد كان في استهداف مباشر لكثير من الزملاء وللأسف فقدوا حياتهم أو هم قيد الاعتقال حتى الآن فالنصيحة أنه يلي حاطت الصحافة هي مهمة أنه مهمة بباله لازم يؤديها لأنه هي واجبة عليه لأنه هو جزء من هدول الناس يعني تعرضوا للموت فما يخلي أي ثغرة توقف وجهه لأنه بالنهاية الإعلام والصحافة هني أساس بإيصال هي الرسالة للدول يعني نحن قمنا بثورة ضد نظام الأسد جزء من هذه الثورة هو الإعلام لحتى نوصل في شيء اللي عم فبتمنى انه ما حدا يخاف ما حدا يتراجع يعني كثير انا بعرف كمان زميلات تراجعوا ما قدروا يكملوا بهذا المجال نتيجه الضغوطات سواء كانت الامنيه او المجتمعيه فانا حابه اقول لهم انه مو من اول موقف سيء ممكن يواجهك ترجعي لورا لانه هو اساسا طريق محفوف بالمخاطر هو طريق ما معبد بالزهور لا انما هو جدا فيه مخاطر فتكون قد الهدف اللي هي اختارته لتقدر توصل لطموحة وتوصل رسالة المحيط اللي هي عايشة فيه.
These are beautiful words and we've had similar ones from you, Gulchehra, today. Thank you so much to both of you, not just for being with us, but also for the extraordinary work that you both do.
Sorry, can I put a little bit?
Of course, please. Go ahead.
What does it mean to be female journalist? I forgot to tell you.
No, please. Love to hear that.
Yeah. I used to think that if we have good writing and impressive speech skills, then you can be a successful journalist. Later on, I thought that these requirements are far from being enough. As long as you leave an authoritarian state, there's no freedom of speech. For in such a state, you are only forced to write and speak for it. Then I came to US and become a Uyghur journalist in the RFA more than a decade. My experience in the US as a journalist taught me that in order to be a journalist, you don't need to be a good speaker, but a good listener. Good listener. And do not a good thinker, but a good guide to encourage others to speak up what they feel, think, and hope for. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Those are beautiful words to end on. Thank you to both of you. It's been a pleasure getting to spend this time with you both. Thank you so much.
Thank you and congratulations. I am now excited to welcome Jamila Jamil in conversation with Dr. Deepika Chopra, two women who are at the forefront of celebrating progress, not perfection. Jamila Jamil rose to fame as Tahini in the Golden Globe nominated series, The Good Place, and is currently the host of the TBS game show, The Misery Index. In addition to her on-screen career, Jamila launched the movement and activism platform, I Weigh, was started as an idea and an Instagram page became an online platform, YouTube channel, podcast, and community of changemakers who come together to share ideas, experiences, and ultimately mobilize activism. Dr. Chopra is an optimism doctor, professional psychologist, mental health advocate, founder of Things Are Looking Up Optimism Card Deck, and host of the podcast, Looking Up with Dr. Deepika Chopra. Dr. Chopra is working towards redefining the popular yet impossible notion of being positive all the time, exposing toxic positivity, and advocating for resiliency over perfection. Welcome.
Thank you so much for that lovely introduction. I am so honored and excited to be having this very important conversation with Jamila Jamil. So Jamila, you are most well known for your career as an actress, but what was the defining moment that made you start I Weigh?
I've been an activist since I was 19. So the last 15 years has been leading up to I Weigh, but the moment exactly was seeing a picture of the Kardashians, you know, who, whatever anyone's opinions of them are, they have created an empire. They are, you know, they have achieved so much in business. This is a family of billionaires. It was a group shot of all of the women in the family. And there were numbers written across the bodies of the women of this family. And those numbers weren't how many awards they've won or how much net worth they have, which are significant things in business. Instead, it was just how much they weigh. And because of the algorithms and social media, once I clicked on that post, more posts that were similar started coming to me of Selena Gomez and Taylor Swift and all these different iconic women who've achieved so much in their careers, still only reduced down to a number and a scale. And I think I just, having suffered with an eating disorder for 20 years, kind of snapped that I can't believe that the belief system I had at 12 years old, that my value was determined by numbers on a scale, is still being upheld even for the most successful women in the world, the ones who are history making and record breaking. This is still our entire value. So I sort of snapped and I was on Twitter. I didn't have a large following anywhere online. And I just said, I weigh my financial independence and my contributions to society, my relationships, my friends, my struggles, the anorexia I've survived, etc. I weigh the sum of all of my parts. And there was just something about the moment that seemed to capture people's imagination. It went super viral around the world, and it's kind of organically turned into this giant movement that's now been going on for almost 3 years. We have almost 1.5 million followers on Instagram. We participate in changing bills and global policies, and now it's a kind of mental health movement that challenges society's decision to value, especially women, based solely on our external appearance.
I'm really glad that you brought that up. It's unbelievable that exactly what you said, that something that a belief system that we may have had at 12 years old, me included, I mean, the magazines that we looked at as young girls and what was deemed important and deemed beautiful, and the way that impacted us in a negative way is actually still going on all the time as adults. And a lot of adult women are actually even unknowingly sort of promoting that and going with it as well, because it's what we're fed. Mm. I'm so happy that you brought up that, you know, you've actually worked to change global policies. I know you have at Facebook, Instagram, and you've worked on campaigning for two bills. Can you talk about that as well?
Yeah, basically, I've had the tremendous fortune of being able to work with people like Harvard Striped and NIDA on just making sure that this doesn't become a kind of passing moment, a kind of pop culture moment of, you know, mouthy actress having a go at the diet industry. We need to actually implement legislation or, you know, just some sort of government interference with a diet industry that has absolutely no moral compass, it would seem. The way that they prey on people, the tactics they use, the misinformation, the shaming that they implore in order to make people live a healthier life, never ever taking into account their mental health, which I think is way more important. So we are working on one bill to end weight stigma in schools. And so I just spoke at Congress regarding that. We're working on another bill, which is a tax incentive for companies that no longer airbrush their photographs because of the false advertising and the ways in which we now have got proven studies that show the impact of airbrushing on the way that people perceive themselves. And finally, diet detox products for under 18s. We're trying to get them off the shelves and trying to no longer allow them to be available online, because they have things like, you know, for the muscle gain products for the boys who also want to look Instagram hot, you know, with the big six pack. They have Viagra and toxic heavy metals in a lot of these products. And the girls' products have elements of speed or laxatives in almost all of them. And these things are never declared, not only by the, you know, incredibly irresponsible celebrities and influencers who flog these products, but also they're not really reported by the companies. And I can't believe that there isn't any kind of legislation that states that if you are going to advertise these products anywhere, similarly with cigarettes or really any drug whatsoever on the market, you don't have to have a disclaimer of side effects right under the post. You just have this photoshopped, beautiful image of someone who doesn't even use that product. I know that for a fact. Flogging these products without telling anyone what they're in for. And as someone who used to take these products as a child, I have seen that 20 years later, I'm still suffering from side effects of having put those things into my body. There are 24,000 children admitted into hospital a year, or 24,000 people, I believe, under 18s, who are hospitalized a year with these products, and no one knows. So I've kind of taken it upon myself to be a whistleblower who's probably very unpopular with the diet and detox industry, but fuck them.
Well, I think that what makes you so different and why I have so much respect for you is I think it's one thing to call out a brand or products or the influencers and celebrities or whoever are flogging these products. And then it's a whole nother thing to actually partake in reform and really talk about how we can change. And nowadays we've been hearing so much about this notion of cancel culture. But what I see on my end is that IWAY is really more about teaching rather than punishing. And so can you kind of elaborate on this idea of promoting progress over perfection and reformation?
Yeah, so what I've been able to turn IWAY into is a sort of allyship platform, right? You know, this is a year where I think everyone has realized more than ever before how little they know about other people's experiences and how much we need to step up and no longer be complicit in our silence and ignorance. And so, unfortunately, there aren't many places that someone who isn't well-informed can turn to where they won't feel incredibly judged or cancelled for previous ignorance or ignorance that they may perhaps still have. And so I wanted to create a safe space for people to come and learn where wherever you're at in your social justice knowledge, it's okay. We don't care about what you don't know. We are excited for what you are about to learn with us. And, you know, I'm an ignorant person. I left school at 16 years old. I do certainly do not claim to have all information about everything. And so I learn publicly on the platform via our YouTube channel and via our podcast and on our Instagram from great experts who come in and educate me, and other people are able to learn alongside me. And even if I make a mistake, I utilize those mistakes as teaching moments so that I can prevent other people from making mistakes. You don't always have to learn from your own mistakes. You can learn from mine instead. So I think it's really important that we start to champion progress over perfection. That is the overriding statement of IWAY. And I don't think this kind of moral purity that we seem to be in search of in this generation, which is really just a side effect of perfectionism culture, which has dominated my generation. Mm-hmm. This idea you have to look perfect, your lifestyle has to be perfect, you have to have the perfect relationship, the perfect children, the perfect dog. And now the perfect social justice knowledge of all different minorities from all over the world. This idea is incredibly stifling, I think, for young people. And so I'm trying to undo that by just making learning cool again and trying to destigmatize failure and rejection. And as someone who doesn't make myself disappear whenever I fail or I stumble, I'm glad to be a role model for progress, for change, and for redemption.
You know, as someone that studies the science behind optimism and resiliency, you know, a huge part of creating more optimism and resiliency is this idea of sitting in curiosity. And I think that's so important and so overlooked, just this idea of saying, I don't know, and I'm actually kind of excited to learn, or I'm open to receive, or I'm open to learn. And also on another sort of, I always have to bring science into it, because I'm a bit of a little bit of a science nerd, but we learn our best. The best potent form of learning is through mistake. And that is scientific evidence and how the brain works. And so what we know is that we remember more, our memory sets in more, and we actually learn more from mistakes that we make. And so if we're not allowing people to make mistakes
and to actually give them a safe space and a platform to change and grow, then we're not learning at all. And so
no, and right. I think it's important to make sure that we are clear on the fact that there are some people who do irrevocable harm and they make the same mistake Absolutely. Repeatedly. We have to have boundaries for how many times you can overstep the line in a way that will actually harm or endanger a marginalized group. You know, someone like, for example, J.K. Rowling, who was just doubling down on harmful misinformation sometimes about a certain group. I think in those instances, it's not my place to decide to cancel anyone, but I think that she would have to do significant work and make significant amends in order to be able to be, you know, re-accepted by certain communities who stand against her values. Harvey Weinstein, all these kind of different people, not say that they are equal in their harm. I'm just giving examples of people who've done irrevocable harm where, yes. you know, so what am I trying to say? So I think it's important just to be kind of boundaried in the ways in which that we decide who gets to accept and forgive whom. But I definitely think that we also need to learn how to separate ignorance from evil. You know, I think that we always assume that if anyone makes a mistake or uses the wrong word or perhaps doesn't yet understand pronouns, for example, or understanding disabled access, that doesn't mean that they actively hate the group that they don't know about. It doesn't mean they want to actively infringe upon their rights. It just means that they now need to learn. And I think if someone shows that they are receptive, if someone is willing to be fully apologetic and then make effort to not just say the right thing, but to do the right thing. I think action is the thing that we really need. And I do think that while cancel culture has become very toxic, it has been an amazing tool to wake people up, to make them realize that you can't just put an apology on your notes app online or say sorry to someone who is a colleague of yours at work and then just get away with it, that you are pressured to actually come back and be and do better and be accountable and responsible. So for that, I think cancel culture has been incredibly helpful. However, I think we've now turned a corner where we've become so trigger happy with it that I worry that we're discouraging people from putting their hands up. And, you know, I worry that kids are watching the way that we all talk to each other and the way that we talk about public figures. And they're thinking, God, you know, if I ever make a mistake or if I've made a mistake in the past, then I shouldn't even bother trying to join in with activism because I'll just be eaten alive. Right. It's better for me to stay silent because we protect the silent and we savage those who try. And we need to normalize and be enthusiastic about people scrapping in wherever they're at. I mean, how far along do we think we are when it comes to equality that we can turn people who want to help away? What right. do we think we're doing? And so, you know, we need all the help we can get, and especially those with more privilege than us or with money or with power and influence. If they are willing to turn back on their old values and join the fight, I welcome them in. And so I think that we just need to be thoughtful about what our actual end goal is.
Right. And it's not just, right. I think that's such an important point. It kind of brings me back to why I admire and respect your work so much, because you take it past that. Of course, it's important to call out. It's so important. And I think that's why that's some of the positive of what this sort of cancel culture has brought. And it's making people a lot more aware. And it's also teaching people consequence of the things that the actions they take and the words that they say, and to be more intentional. But I think taking it that step further and okay, I've made a mistake now. I feel awful. I see the light. I'm learning. What can I do? And you guys are offering, you're offering a space for what can I do next?
Yeah,
that's
exactly.
So important. So how does your mission of promoting this idea, do you think, contribute to encouraging those to sort of achieve authenticity within themselves? So like, what advice can you share with us about, you know, those who are seeking lasting positive change, but they don't really know where to begin?
Well, first of all, you can join IWA, which is my movement, and we are very happy to have you and to teach you. Second of all, really make sure that you don't just diversify your feed, which people are learning how to do, but you have to diversify your day in order to actively instill empathy inside of yourself. You're not going to get that through the blue light of a mobile device. You know, if anything, these devices can sometimes have a neurological impact on you that makes you devoid of empathy somewhat. So diversify your day. I know that's difficult during lockdown. And also, you know, be very mindful of what you are taking in. Be not mindful of your news sources. Be mindful of the people that you are choosing to follow and the impact, not only on the way that you think, but also the way that you feel. You know, I refer to it as block, mute, delete, repeat the tactic I use when it comes to just creating self-defense of the mind. I would also say that if you are someone who wants to get into the work of social justice, it's very important. You know, there's a company called Glitch UK, and they talk about the fact that activism should be trauma-informed but not trauma-led, and I think that's really important. And one of the first things I did before, you know, really entering into the most hardcore part of activism was to get mental health care, because it's very stressful, and you also want to make sure that you're not pouring your own damage into the cause, and also that you've checked your ego at the door, and that there's no part of you that has a kind of a motivation to be liked or to be popular, because activism is not necessarily an easy ride, but it's a vital ride. And I feel sad sometimes that people in the news only ever report the fact that I'm sometimes in controversy or in backlash, whereas because I fear that it makes it look like a really stressful, terrible life full of just constant upheaval and struggle. But it isn't. It's just the most wildly fulfilling community and fun experience. It's so much less lonely to understand all of your different neighbors in this world. I think we're so isolated when we confine ourselves to boxes, or when we allow society or politicians to do that. And so I really hope that people look to the beauty of helping one another and understanding that that will help you, and just make sure that you're doing it for the right reasons and not because you want to be adored or win any awards.
Right. You know, something that comes up a lot in my work and with people is, I think that on one hand, being able to have a community online is so powerful, and I think it helps people share, and it gives them sort of this braveness that they may not have in person. But on the other hand, it really like sort of lays a really nice sort of easy plate for someone that is wanting to be a bully, because they're able to sort of stand behind the screen, and whether it's for, you know, a group of people that they are bullying or just one person. I know for me personally, I experienced something recently that I've never experienced before. I'm a mom. I have a 3-week-old and a 3-year-old, and I was holding my child, and I posted a story. He was sort of like, we were doing skin to skin. He was laying on me, and I covered his face, and my face wasn't really seen either. And this person took my picture, posted it all, I don't know her, all over a Facebook group on safe sleeping, and decided to just shame me and say that I was promoting unhealthy, safe sleeping for infants, which I wasn't, but that's besides the point. And I mean, this was like to a group of almost 100,000 people, and the comments were just like, F her, she doesn't deserve to have a kid, all these things. And so I, as a professional, even having all the tools, obviously I was very hurt. I posted a video not talking about her name or any information, and I just was very raw and open, and how mom shaming is such a big thing, especially online, and my feelings were hurt, and it was very raw. And immediately, or maybe 2 days later, I got a very long email from her, and she said, by the way, that was me. I'm so sorry. I saw you as a person when I saw your video. I saw your feelings. I didn't look at you as a person before. I looked at you as sort of this influencer, or you know, someone that I don't know that doesn't have feelings, and I feel awful. And I believe I was mom shaming. I took it down, and I just joined that group. And so there is this change that can happen from being authentic, even with your hurt, which I think is really incredible. Like, people were like, give me her screen name. I want to, you know, and that wasn't the point. It wasn't about shaming with shame. It was about teaching something. But I really wanted to ask you how, obviously I'm interested in optimism, and how do you think optimism is used within activism, and how do you really define optimism?
Well, first of all, I'm sorry that happened to you, and I'm glad that you were able to resolve it. That's not often the case. And I think it's really good that you didn't resort to shaming. And I think it's important that we all just try to really just impact one another's empathy. But when it comes to optimism, I'm not terribly sure that there is enough or necessarily even a lot of optimism in activism sometimes, and I feel as though we desperately need an injection of it, because otherwise what are we fighting for? You know, ultimately, when people don't believe in other people's capacity for change, and when we are unforgiving, there is an underlying question of, well, if you don't really believe that people can change, and you just want to eradicate everyone who's ever made a mistake, and you don't think that they're capable of growth, then A, do you think you're capable of growth? And also then, what is the point of activism in and of itself? So for me, what I have decided to do is just never give up on hope that I can make significant change. And if I build a big enough army of enough people and I continue to be authentic and I continue to be honest and raw and vulnerable and powerful, that I can be a part of the change that I so desperately needed when I was a little girl. And, you know, I wonder all the time about my future. I don't know if enough of us necessarily have been encouraged to look towards the end goal. Sometimes there's so much chaos, and I understand it, there's so much chaos and pain out there that I think people kind of lose sight of what the end of the tunnel looks like. But I am obsessed with the end of the tunnel. Like, I'm a solutionist, and I wouldn't keep doing this. I wouldn't keep refusing to go away in spite of being asked many times by Twitter. I refuse to go away because I genuinely believe that in my lifetime I will see a world in which women are offered the same redemption as men. You know, I've said it before that, you know, we don't have any of the benefit of the doubt left for women because we have spent it all on men. And I wouldn't keep doing this if I didn't have so much ultimate hope and faith in the people that I fight alongside. I work with some of the greatest activists in the world, and inherently there must be some optimism brewing in all of us. Otherwise, we wouldn't take the risks that we take with our lives. We just need, as a society, to hold on to that. I understand why people are beaten down by hopelessness and by the world, but really, optimism is going to be the only thing that's going to carry us through, because without it, really, we are dead. You know, right. What is the point of anything if we don't think that change is possible and that we can hope for a better future? And I'm so lucky to see that even in my short time at this level of activism, I've been able to see and be a part of implementing so much change that further spurs me on. And also just seeing other great movements like the Black Lives Matter movement, or, you know, trans awareness and trans lives matter and Me Too. This to me is a hopeful time of real change, and we are seeing global, cultural, generational conversations completely shift. And also, I for one feel particularly hopeful because I think, well, this year has been absolutely harrowing, and we have lost so many people for such terrible reasons and so much carelessness. I also think that we are shifting into a different paradigm of thought. You know, our value systems are changing. I hope forever in that we no longer are valuing the influencers who are standing on Parisian balconies covered in diamonds, who just promote consumption as a means of living. Instead, we are thinking about the essential workers and mental health care workers and doctors and immigrants who have come over and are serving on the front line. The people who we most distrusted, feared, and ousted, yes, are the ones saving our lives. You know, I think our value systems in that way are changing. We have nurses on the cover of British Vogue, finally. I think that we are looking at actors and actresses and celebrities as useless because they fucking are, and everything they represent is little more than entertainment, and they are inherently quite careless and don't really do very much to help anyone with their tremendous power and influence and money. And so I do think that we are moving away from this capitalist obsession that we were fed in order to restore the economy that was damaged in 2008. That was put upon my generation for us to fix the broken economy around the world. And I think that those days are gone because money really doesn't save all of us. It just saves the very, very select minor few. And so I do think that we are becoming a more thoughtful and more humane generation, and I think we're starting to gather and unite and have difficult conversations and lean in and have empathy for one another, even those we've never met.
Absolutely. I think that you hit the nail on the head. To really believe that people can change is the root of all optimism. And so that's something that is extremely important. And I also think that even though we are in this very traumatic time, it's a huge time for growth and resilience and a lot of optimism. Thank you so much for this conversation. It was so important, so eye-opening, and really inspirational. It was great to sit down with you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jamila and Dr. Chopra. That concludes our morning main stage programming. In case you missed it or want to go back and rewatch your favorite moments, visit wrapwomen.com and click Power Women Summit. At 12:30, and all these times are in Pacific time, we'll reconvene for our first round of breakout sessions, followed by a second round at 1:30. During these breakout sessions, you'll have the opportunity to choose from a variety of panels, workshops, roundtable discussions, and fireside chats. At 2:30, we'll host our mentorship sessions. If you upgraded your ticket to include mentorship, you should have received an email confirmation with your designated date, time, and mentor. At 5, join us for our final closing concert to honor the heroes of COVID-19. Hear from some of your favorite performers, from country music stars to TikTok sensations. In honor of these performances, Wrap Women will be donating money to Women in Film's Hire Her Back Fund, which provides grants to women and people of marginalized genders in the screen industries whose livelihoods in entertainment have been adversely affected by the pandemic. If you are in a position to give, please consider making a contribution of any amount to the Hire Her Back Fund. For more information and to donate, visit Power Women Summit Marketplace and support COVID relief. Thanks everyone for joining me today, and thank you, Wrap Women, for having me. Enjoy the rest of your day.